Okay, Beta Branch 1.5.5 has dropped, and I've done some testing here for you. Let's go over some highlights about the patch notes that you can quickly decide if you even want to keep watching the video. Then I'll tell you whether or not it is save game compatible and whether or not you should test it. So, letting you know up front, there have been some tweaks to Sieges. The way that they've done them is that they've changed the way the computation works when it comes to sending troops or simulating how a siege works. And it mainly has to do with how cavalry will no longer apply its bonus in a siege. They've added a new radial menu for the order system. So if you're playing with a controller, it is now much easier to navigate. They've also done some other tweaks to the game, but mainly they've added perks to both medicine and to tactics, and they've done some massive overhauls to multiplayer. So if you do play multiplayer, Beta Branch 1.5.5 is going to be for you. outside of that, they haven't done a whole ton in 0.5 here. They've changed some autosave intervals, and they've also added the option for the AI to marry, and you can actually turn off the ability for the AI to produce children, yourself included. Honestly, that's the hard and fast breakdown of the patch notes. Like I said, it is campaign compatible, so you don't need to make a new campaign. And on top of it, it is relatively stable. As someone who doesn't experience a lot of crashes, like I'll say later in the video, I did encounter a couple crashes, so I think it's worth testing if you play multiplayer and if you're having a lot of trouble with sieges and you want to test out the new siege implementations. Or if you're playing with a controller, then do this patch. Otherwise, I think you can really pass on this one. There's not a huge stuff done to this to really have a ton of meat to it. But it's been 2 minutes. You can go ahead and shut the video down if you so wish. But for those of you that want to get into the nitty gritty of the Beta Branch notes, let's keep going here. I've highlighted everything. You're going to see either red, green, or cyan. Red and green are either going to be buffs or nerfs, and cyan are just kind of interesting other aside patch notes that I'd like to just kind of quickly hit. So going through this here, there have been a ton of crash fixes. So go through this if you are encountering specific crashes over and over, they might be in this list. From what I looked through here, there wasn't anything huge that I picked up, but it is worth noting. For save and load though, daily gold changes occurred multiple times in different loaded games for some saved games. This was fixed. Now the daily gold change occurs only once in a day. And what that's saying is you might sometimes load the game in, unpause it, and then get charged your daily wages on your party, and then get charged again the next day. So this is a bug that's been fixed, and you can now have that done away with. This should be green. There we go. An autosave interval duration was increased. It now autosaves after leaving settlements and ending encounters. So you should have more autosaves to choose from, which is very nice. Moving into art, we've had improvements to the existing campaign map icons. Now, I didn't see this when I was looking in the game, so I don't know what this means. It might just simply mean a higher resolution. They might actually move across all resolutions in the game at a better rate and not just simply be really sharp at 1080p and really crappy at, I don't know, 4K. I don't know what this really means, but I couldn't really find a huge explanation of this by looking at the game. If you did, and you've playing 1.5.5, please go ahead and let me know in the comment section, but I didn't see anything huge or breathtaking in the new quote-unquote map icons. With the UI though, we had an autosave interval control that was added to the campaign options panel. You'll see that later in the video if you want to see what that looks like. They've added a married and not married filter to the Encyclopedia Heroes List page, which makes it way easier to find a wife of your own or a spouse if you're playing a female character. Added explanation tooltip to the tax value in town management, so you can get a better idea of how that tax is breaking out across every single town or a castle that you own. Players can now load save games with double clicking on the save game tuple rather than just pressing the load game button in the lower right, which I'm sure you're all used to doing by now. Now here's the big chunkus here. Let's try, there we go. Just about everything on the screen. So at the top, we have added a -20% damage and weapon speed reload penalty for using weapons while mounted. This is lowered by the riding skill and reaches zero penalty at 100. It effectively applies to troops and characters in single player mode. Some mechanic weapons, such as crossbows, are exempt from the damage penalty. Now, why this is important is, and why I put it in green more importantly and not in red as a nerf, is that if you start a character that has a bow and arrow and you're on horseback, you're not going to be this god amongst men that you were before. You now have that 20% penalty that you're going to face until you increase your riding skill up to 100. So I actually find this to be a good thing, because I find that when you're playing a horse archer character, you're too good too fast. And this creates a nice natural progression to the game, rather than starting the game at like power level 7 and then progressing to 10 by the end. You actually kind of have to get better through actual riding skill. And I think that this is a perfectly fine and agreeable change to the game. I think a lot of people might not like this because they're going to start out at a lower power level, meaning that they're going to have a penalty of 20% damage to their melee and range weapons. But again, I really like this. I think it really creates a better progression and a quote-unquote narrative for your character. Heroes will no longer receive medicine skill experience for team kills and battles. I put this in red because I think a lot of people might have been abusing this. Basically, you can do team kills after a battle is won if you're using a bow. It's a holdover from the old assassin system that was in the game prior to early access and the beta portions of it when they had class systems. So if you were doing that to try and get your medicine skill up, you can no longer do that. Some archery points in siege scenes were not being removed as expected when certain objects like walls and broken versions of walls were swapped around, causing archer agents trying to go to undesirable positions. So what this means is, if you destroyed a portion of a wall or you destroyed a Merlin with your catapults or with your siege engines, it was making it so the AI would still try to get to those locations on the wall, and they would just run into a broken portion of the wall and then just get killed, or not even do anything, or not even shoot their bows and arrows. So this has been fixed, which is huge. Also, in addition to that, Fixed added more functionality to add on deploy remove on deploy properties. Moving and formation speed limits were not applied properly. They have been fixed and speeds were reduced overall. This is especially noticeable in shield wall, circle, and square arrangements. You're going to see this later in the video. I show this off a little bit, but and I also talk about this in that portion of the video, but the way that this is going to work now, this was done a couple patches ago, right? They fixed shield wall. Things now move as a cohesive blob, but they still don't quite move as a cohesive blob. They still can kind of get a little skeined. They can push out a little in front in certain portions. What I've noticed is, if you have a mixed unit of javelin men or even infantry soldiers that have throwing weapons like Pelum, they will get kind of disjointed in the AI of the shield wall. So in order to fully take advantage of this change, you'll want to take anyone that has a throwing weapon and separate them into their own category. So they will be in a shield wall and they will walk together, but they'll stop and throw their javelins at the same time and in a cohesive fashion, versus mixing this, both throwing weapon infantry and just standard shield infantry. The shield infantry will kind of push ahead of the throwing weapon infantry, and it will cause gaps in your shield wall. So even though this has been implemented, and it is really good because it does make it move much, much slower, you can still have gaps. So be wary of this one. When troops with ranged weapons were given the charge order, they didn't approach the enemy if there was a friend in the way. This was fixed. Moving sideways to try to see enemies' past friends was also added, making giving the charge order without telling troops to hold fire much more effective. So you can now have ranged troops that are actually going to be shooting into the enemy without getting blocked by their own friendly agents. Implemented a new system that calculates troop power based on context. Removed cavalry troop simulation bonuses for siege. And I think it's like a 20% bonus for cav in simulation. So they've removed that because they don't use their horses in sieges, and that's what was giving them that bonus. Light crossbows are reloadable on horseback now. Finally, some of the heaviest crossbows are capable of penetrating shields. Also, finally. Character development added 10 more combat-related tactics perks to the game. This finalizes the current tactics skill tree. We'll show that off later, as well as the medicine perks, the 32 balanced campaign side benefits of the medicine perks. fixed a bug that causes troops to appear as a very old or young. So now, rather than being these old haggard men, they are just the normal troop age that they were once before. This was because of patch 1.5.4. So if you skipped 1.5.4, you didn't even see this. So you're totally fine. Clan and party enabled AI marriages to occur over time. So that means that the AI will start to have children and they will have legacies, which is very cool and it kind of creates that living environment that we wanted in Bannerlord. Gave most clans enough adult members to lead the minimum number of parties, added children to some clans to ensure better long-term continuity. More changes will follow. So those two patch notes alone tell us that they're really planning for that long haul, for that succession system, for that the marriage system to give way to children and the education system. So they're trying to now build in a lot of that long-term continuity into the game, and I'm really excited to see how that progresses across the next couple months. Fixed an issue that caused caravan speeds to drop to 1-2 speed because they were buying too many animals. So now they'll hopefully won't get just kind of stuck across the map because they've just overpurchased animals and given themselves too much of a herd limit. Fixed a problem with tanneries not making any profit and closing all over the world in the long term. So thank God. And also, all workshops are a bit. It's happened. Finally, you can become the Ferengi overlord of Calradia you always wished and have your workshops now be producing once more. I have noticed that it's not an astronomical bit more profitable, but it is a lot more palatable. It was before like, okay, you get like 80 for your workshop. I've now noticed I can get up to 250 yet again, which is a good amount in my opinion. So I'm okay with that. I don't think workshops should make the game go on autopilot. I think that should be more of the caravans and workshops working in conjunction and having a lot of them if you want to make a trade empire. But workshops are once again a reliable form of income. Quest battle AI aggressiveness has been improved. Quest NPCs will be more defensive in combat based on their skills. Quest difficulties will now scale according to player progress, even while the quest is ongoing, which is nice that you'll constantly have quests that will give you a challenge versus them always being, okay, well, I'll do this one because it's easy and quick, or I don't want to do this one because it is too easy and quick. So those have at least progressed up with you. And a number of other quest changes, but nothing to stand out to me. Villagers and guards should change their dialogue if the player is lord of their settlement or faction ruler. And why I put this one in highlights is because I found it kind of jarring playing the game, owning a castle or owning a town and talking to a peasant and they go, oh yeah, the lord here is real nice. I'm like, that's me, dude. You're talking to your third, you're like fourth person talking about me and also the faction ruler. So it's nice to see that this kind of immersiveness is being brought into the game on just simply the base dialogue level with villagers and guards. I think that's really cool. Nice touch. Basic units will no longer use polearm type of weapons as they were getting too good at stopping cavalry charges. Changed a few tournament loadout matchups for Batania and Asurai. Fights between all range units and ranged versus two-handers are less likely to happen, which is nice because I feel like you were getting too homogenous of a tournament every time you did both Batania or Asurai. Changed armors and shields for caravan guards of Sturgia, Landia, and Empire. And I haven't seen how this really plays out aside from them having a different loadout, but I haven't noticed if the caravans themselves last, I guess, better or they actually perform worse. So we'll see how that goes as I continue to play through this patch. Added player spouse death notification. So now you can finally know when your wife dies. Added an option to enable disable birth, aging, and death in the campaign. With this option enabled, no hero will be born, and no one will die in the game. So the game, when you boot it up, will stay the exact same. So if you so wish, you can have that. So another big thing is with item modifiers. So while modifiers worked mostly as intended for armors, they did not for weapons. Stats of weapons were not affected by them. That has been fixed. So now if you have a rusty sex, S-E-A-X, then it will now properly show that it has less damage than, say, a fine sex or spatho, so on and so forth. Not all items have the correct modifiers associated with them. That's been fixed. And now the modifiers should properly stack. So it used to be that if you had, let's just say, a rusty spatha, a fine steel spatha, actually a fine steel spatha is a whole different spatha, just different variations of the modifier of a weapon, you could sometimes bug the game out and they would all stack as one standard version of it. It would just say Spatha. So that has now been fixed and they will properly stack their respective modifiers and not just kind of combine into one. I put this in red because it is dangerous and you should be mindful of it. Lame horse feature was implemented. So when your horse goes down in a mission, there's a chance that it will get the lame modifier, which will affect the stats of it permanently. Unless you have the riding skill that can help negate this or greatly reduce it, be very careful if your horse dies. it could possibly become lame. For multiplayer, we've had a ton of changes. Bows, crossbows, and all throwing weapons, reading and aiming duration, and patterns are now related to the weapon speed. Aiming used to be standard for all ranged weapons. This is the same thing that they've seen we've seen teased in the dev diary. So say a heavy crossbow takes longer to acquire a target, but it will do more damage versus a light crossbow, which will acquire a target quicker, but not do as much damage. A new perk for bows and crossbows, faster release, grants faster traveling projectiles to increase the effective range of bows and crossbows. Does not increase the damage value. Also, again, keep in mind this is for multiplayer. Crush through is only possible with a Batanian two-handed mace and Sturgian two-handed hammer. Both weapons swing speed and damage have been adjusted. So if you were relying on crush damage trying to get into that third bracket or the third person, it's only possible now with your two-handed mace and that two-handed hammer. So if you're relying on it, keep that in mind. Also, a number of weapons have been added to multiplayer, which are not in single player. The Volandian Bastard Sword, the Western Bastard Sword, I looked these all up. They're unfortunately not. So I'm hoping that they do eventually become portions of the multiplayer. We already get a Bastard Sword, so I'm wondering if the fact that it's Batanian, Volandian, Western, this means it has a certain aesthetic. I'm not very sure. But I wanted to highlight these because I hope that they come to single player. I'd like to see more additions to weapons and armor in multiplayer or single player. So a number of balances across so many things, so many different weapons and items and troops have all been done to multiplayer. So please go and check this out if you've been playing a ton of multiplayer. I myself unfortunately have not. But we have now the new mission order radial menu. As you can see here, this is going to be changing stuff around here. If you're really using a gamepad or a controller, this is going to be a lot easier for you. Because of this, some orders have been moved. F1 and F2 orders are unaffected, but F3 through F7 orders are now under a list. F3, like F1 and F2. We're open to feedback about this change, so let us know what you think. In my opinion, not a much changed on this. I was using it a second ago, and you'll see it later in this video. F1, F3 works. F1, F4 works. Like all the stuff that I was using before, for the most part, hasn't changed enough for me to really be jarred by this. But let me know in the comment section if you feel that you are being jarred by it, because they will watch these videos and read these the feedback of people in comment sections and forums and Reddits. So let your opinion be known, guys. It's super huge to the further development of the game. Performance optimization across the board here. And of course, I always like to see these in patch notes. It's telling us that the game is getting more and more optimized. If you compare the game now optimization to where it was back in March, it is night and day difference. It is so huge. Fix a scenario for crush through where the attacker could deal full damage to the opponent. So it's supposed to be you hit one person, you have a chance to crush through to the second, and an even smaller chance to crush through to the third. And each subsequent crush through should do less damage. So this was going all the way to full damage every time. So if you're relying on crush through damage, be mindful, it has now been fixed for both single and multiplayer. Improved aiming and decision making process for archer AI and improved AI behavior while charging when they have throwing weapons equipped. But those are the patch notes for 1.5.5. There is quite a bit more than I thought we would be covering because it's not a huge amount of patch notes, but let's jump into the game now and show some of these things off. We don't have a ton of stuff to show off in game. Most of it's been under the hood tweaks and changes. Let's swap over to the actual in-game for Bannerlord. Here we are in the game. Let's show off both the medicine and the tactics perks. I'm not going to go through every single one, but I just want to show off some of them so you can see them real quick that they have been added to the game. And tactics has got a lot of really interesting things going for it because I think it's something we can finally focus on and get actual set perks from it. For one, tactics simulation advantage is 5.6 right now. for my current skill level at 56. So if you want simulation advantage, which is essentially auto resolve, if you're thinking of it from a Total War perspective, basically just sending troops and tactics is going to increase that percentage or that advantage. And as we navigate through this, we can see stuff like small unit tactics, which is huge. Plus one troop joins you when fighting in hideouts. Very nice. I think there's another cool one here. It's Horde Leader. Plus 10 party size, which is great here. Another cool one is parties that you have called to your army move 10% faster while moving to the army and 15% less influence required per party to call to your army. You can make huge armies here with call to arms, helping you get much higher and better leadership faster. Pick them off the walls, 25% attrition against siege defender personnel and attrition against besieger personnel. So depending on whether or not you are sieging or besieging, you can help out that attrition. On the march, reduce fortification bonus in simulations by 20%. Increase fortification bonus in simulations by 20%, depending on if you are an army commander or the governor. So if you have one of your party characters with really high tactics, it now can make sense to have them governor a location because they will increase that fortification bonus by 20%. Remember, there was a lot of tweaking to the way sieges are done, especially when it comes to cavalry applying their cavalry bonus in a siege. Well, they're not going to be using their horses to siege the walls. They're going to be getting off their horses for almost every single siege that you do. So, well, in fact, they start with off their horses. So you can see how they're really trying to fine tune a lot of stuff with sieges. And I think tactics should help out with that in some way, shape, or form. Besiege is another good example here. When you are besieged, 10% more damage in simulations and 50% more influence gain from winning sieges. And our last one on this list is Tactical Mastery. Increase simulation damage by 1% for every skill level over 200. So a lot of really great perks here in tactics. The first two are even really cool. Tight formations, your infantrymen deal 10% more damage to cavalry in simulations, and your troops receive 25% less morale penalty from casualties when using shield wall, square, skein, or column formations. I think all of us use shield wall. Then loose formations here, basically 25% less morale with line, loose, circle, or scatter formations. So this would be really good if you want to use a lot of archers. If you're using a lot of horse archers, you maybe want to go more with loose formations. If you're going more with infantry or obviously heavy shock cavalry, then tight formations maybe makes a little bit more sense. Jumping into medicine, though, we have some little secondary additions to these. Sledges here increases your troops' mounts' health by 15. Siege medic, 30% increased chance to recover lethal wounds in siege assaults. So anytime you see those patch notes that says added 32 new campaign mechanics, it's usually telling you that the first line, well, one of these lines is combat oriented and one of them is campaign oriented. And usually that's how they do these perks. They'll retool some of them after they've already added them and then say, okay, these are campaign and these are battle perks that have been redone or added in. Physician of People increases loyalty of settlement by 1 per day, and then tier 1 and 2 troops have 30% higher chance to recover from fatal wounds. So if you are dealing with a lot of, you have a party member that is your surgeon, because it says governor or surgeon, tier 1 and tier 2 troops have your 30% higher chance to recover from fatal wounds. So you're going to be, it's going to be easier for you to train up tier 1 and 2 troops because they're not going to die off as easily. So a lot of really great stuff being added here. Bush Doctor increases village hearth grown great by 20% and get 20% healing done bonus or healing bonus in villages. One other thing I do want to cover. Oh, let's go to this last one real quick. Minister of Health, troops start battles with a bonus hit points of player's medicine skill minus 200 divided by 2. You can see that can be pretty gnarly. So at 275 minus 200, that's 75. Divide that by 2. That's whatever number that is that I can't remember off the top of my head. 35.5, I think. I don't know. But that is definitely not the number. One of the other things I wanted to cover though is riding and the change to riding. Remember what it said? You now start with a penalty to your damage when you are on a horse. Right now, because we have 162 riding, we don't have that penalty. And it disappears around 100. So the Sagittarius or the Sweeping Wind selections. I myself am a fire sign, so I chose Sagittarius. But if you so choose, after you pass through 100, you'll notice that these two things have dialed down to zero. Mounted weapon damage penalty is at 0%, and weapon speed and reload penalty is at 0%. And this, I know that this is a bit of a nerf, but right now, as it was, if you started the game, playing as an archer is so strong. So they kind of curtailed that back a little bit. You need to be better at riding a horse before you can be this god amongst horse archers. So I'm actually kind of okay with this mechanic. Let's jump now into the battlefield to show off that new radial menu and how things are moving when it comes to formation movement across the map. We jumped into a battle here to show off the new radial menu. Now, this is really going to apply more if you are using a controller, but more importantly, it's going to be kind of confusing. So just kind of be mindful that when you're stepping into this, you're going to, it's not coming to the left side, obviously, but everything for the most part, as far as the function keys, has stayed the same. So, okay, I'm going to press F2 and I'm going to press, not shield wall, but scan. There we go. And they're going to just do F1, F1 and move to position. Everything is going to be as it was. It's just basically a little kind of confusing to see what's going on at first. So just kind of be mindful of that when you do use this. Let's go ahead and hit shield wall. And have them charge. So you see they're kind of moving a little bit more in line now. With one of the more recent patches, they did fix the shield wall with everyone moving kind of around the same rate, but it looks like that variable speed did get affected over time, and it was actually not working as fully intended. With this most recent patch, I've noticed that formations tend to stick even closer to what they were before, which is good to see. I didn't even notice there was that big of an issue, but it's nice to see that they've noticed these little changes and they're fixing them. I'm going to unpause and we're going to be able to see that a little bit more. I just wanted to, I guess, diatribe a little bit before we jump back into it. So let's return and watch this thing kind of move. It's still not as cohesive, and it's probably because we've got men in the back with javelins. But from my kind of initial testing on it, it just seems to be that all the formations themselves work a little bit more fluid, or at least a little bit more dynamically. Infantry, going. Archers should now be able to just simply charge and shoot and not get blocked by their own things. Or their own men, I mean. But that kind of solves things here on the combat map. You can see he's kind of, they're trying to get in line. Let's get them to form up here. Cavalry guy, I gotcha. Move you over there. Oh, everyone's just this is just disgusting. There we go. Footmen, move! Footmen! Infantry, I'll get these guys right here. Yeah, see, they move a lot slower, more paced now. If they ever want to get into position, they're having a grand old time. So if we move them over there. Yeah, they really kind of take their time moving in locations now. It seems that if you do have a mixed unit where they are trying to throw javelins at the same time, it will kind of mess up the overall formation strength, or at least the formation cohesion. So if you have javelin-wielded units, either put them in their own formation, like skirmishers, battalion skirmishers, or even saying any infantry soldiers that have javelins, maybe put them in their own formation together too, to kind of keep that cohesion together. This shows off some of the in-game stuff, especially the new radial menu. This is going to be easier to access if you are using that controller, but for the most part. The nice thing about this is, it used to be you pressed F2 and you were locked into that screen. Well, now I can press F1, right-click, and this stays up. So I know, okay, F2, good to go. F3, toggle. So it's a little bit easier to kind of navigate around, even if you're not using a controller, as it were. So I do like this, but it did take me a little bit to get used to it. Even still, I'm kind of a little wonky with it because it's just not on the left side. My eye keeps going there naturally. So be mindful of that when you do play 1.5.5, it will be a little jarring at first. And our last thing I want to cover before we close our video out is a new campaign option here. Go to campaign options and autosave interval and slide this to and from however you want, disabling it outright or going all the way for your 60-minute interval. It starts default at 15. So you have choices now for your autosave interval within your campaign options. But guys, that concludes everything for the 1.5.5 beta branch. I will be honest, I have noticed some crashes with this, even just simply coming out of combat. So should you test this? I think you can. I don't think there's a problem with it necessarily. I would just say, as someone who rarely experiences crashes, I have experienced crashes this time around. So it might be because I put a new graphics card into my computer, and that might be kind of doing haywire stuff as I've tweaked around some of my graphical settings, but do be mindful of that. You might be dealing with a little bit more crashes than normal, and this isn't a huge patch. I'm hoping the next one is that massive one that adds education that they teased and some of the other fun stuff that they talked about in their latest dev diary. I think 1.5.5 is a bit of a holdover to get to that big juicy one up ahead. So should you test? I think if some of the stuff excites you, go for it. If not, I think you're totally fine staying on 1.5.4. Everything is save compatible, so you're good to go, as it were. Don't feel the need to jump to the next version if you don't want to just yet. You're not going to miss out on anything huge. But as always, guys, thank you so much for watching here today. Don't forget to like, subscribe, comment below, all that kind of fun action, and let me know what your thoughts are on 1.5.5. I will be covering it on the channel via streaming for the next couple days here, in between content with Total War, the Twisted and the Twilight, the new DLC coming out for that. So we'll have some videos and streams coming out for Bannerlord. But as always, again, thank you so much for watching. Have a good one and take care.